Good evening and welcome to the Stephen Leeson Show, brought to you live from the Scientology Community Centre here in Dublin. And it's my pleasure once again to be presenting the show along with Angel. It's great to have these paintings here on these items.
I know, it's incredible. Yeah. Love this one.
Folks, in this week's show, we're expanding our coverage of the arts, ambitious though that may seem. Normally, as you know, music is our main feature, but there's a lot more to the field of art and creativity, and you might say another dimension of the creative process in the visual arts. Sometimes it's not always possible to go to a gallery to look at some paintings that can make you see the world in a different way. So tonight, we're going to bring some to you. They're by one of our guests, and you'll see some of them on the performance stage and more later when we meet the artist himself, who is Glenn Matthews. But to begin, let me introduce our first guest, Denise Brennan. Denise is from the Garden of Ireland, which is, of course, County Wicklow, and is a professional singer and songwriter. She's toured internationally with Riverdance, Women of Ireland, the Dublin Philharmonic Orchestra, and Celtic Gold, where she has taken centre stage as a soloist in opera houses and theatres to thousands over the years. Denise is thrilled to be singing on the show, accompanied by the incredible Dave Doc O'Connor on piano. Folks, please welcome Denise Brennan.
If life is a wild wind that knows That was the beautiful No Frontiers, written by the incredible Jimmy McCarthy. This next song was a favorite in Scotland, so popular that it was sung to ring in the new year until Robert Burns wrote Auld Lang Syne. It's been a firm favorite here in Ireland for many, many years, and it's my pleasure to sing it here tonight for the first time. This is The Parting Glass. Of all the money that e'er I've had, I spent it in good company, and all the harm that e'er I've done, alas, it was to none but me. So I hear it was Barbra Streisand's birthday 2 weeks ago, and I know Barbra's tuning in tonight, because let's face it, why wouldn't she, right? So Barbra, this is for you, The Way We Were. colored pictures of the smiles we left behind, smiles we gave to one another, of the way we were. Can it be that it was all so simple then, or has time rewritten every line? And if we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we? Could we?
Well,
absolutely beautiful singer. It was great to hear the Jimmy McCarthy song.
Beautiful.
I wasn't expecting it at No Frontiers at the start. It was a lovely, lovely performance.
For me, it's the Memories one.
Yeah.
I always feel real emotional listening to the Memories one.
Of course.
Because it is true. Could you go through all that again? You know, all those memories. And,
yeah.
Or would you? Could you? Who knows?
I'm looking for folks hang around as well, because Denise is coming back on to us in a while as well, like, you know, and with more and a bit of a surprise, because. Anyway,
beautiful.
I'm sure you noticed the incredible paintings in our musical art gallery. These are for our next guest, Glenn Matthews. And Glenn grew up in the leafy suburbs of Carrieduff, Belfast, and studied art to A level, then dropped out to level school to become a drummer in a rock and roll band, as you do. And he's here with us tonight to tell us about his journey from living that particular dream to the one he's living now, as an accomplished and internationally recognised painter. Glenn, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
How are you?
I'm still laughing at that intro.
I know you love the intro.
Dear God, how am I going to live up to that?
You know, it's great to have you on the show.
Thanks very much for the invitation.
I was stalking your Instagram the last few days.
Yeah, I've seen that. Yeah, don't believe. There's about 50% of it
I'm
can believe.
I'm going to start clicking, liking everything.
Good.
You know, you're kind of multi-talented and you started off, you started off initially drumming and that was down to the influence of Led Zeppelin for you.
Yeah, friends of mine had formed a band and I always wanted to be a drummer, but at that couldn't afford a drum kit. I was only a kid. And anyway, three lads, mates, started a band. And I went to listen to one of their rehearsals and the drummer was terrible. I made him, I still is, it won't be now. And I said, look, get out of my way. I'll show you what you should be doing. And about 3 weeks later, he sold me the kit. So I became a drummer. First gig was a school concert. And then, yeah, it just sort of blossomed. My musical career, I don't know if I would say that, but it progressed anyway. Gigging around Belfast, gigging around Ireland.
You obviously liked drumming. It wasn't just, you just did decide just to get up
no,
and take,
well, I,
take over
I,
the
I
kit.
Still now, if I'm listening to music, I listen to the drum.
Yeah.
Drums and bass, and I have no clue about lyrics and very few songs.
And did you end up playing full-time, playing the drums full-time?
Well, yeah. Yeah. We did. We were okay. We were signed up to Good Vibrations, record label The Undertones,
wow.
Famously. Terry Hewlett
yeah.
was our manager, who famously went over to and tortured John Peel into playing The Undertones' Teenage Kicks. Didn't do the same for us, but anyway, you know, we did okay. We played gigs around. We played the Marquee in London, which was...
That's great.
For me,
you know?
Well, for all of us at the time, like that was... Kids won't have a clue what the Marquee is, but the Marquee was the club. In London, everyone played the Stones. Like, just everyone, Jimi Hendrix, everyone has played the Marquee Club. So, yeah, we got a gig there, and a few gigs, four or five times we played there. And, yeah.
What age were you at that time?
I don't know, I was 21, 22,
right, so yeah.
Something like that.
Tell us about the Paul Brady's.
Yeah.
Like, this is hilarious.
Oh,
we
had the gig. This is, I think, our fourth gig in the Marquee. And like we were loving life, having a few pints in the green room before going on. And Terry wasn't over, but someone came into the room and said, lads, listen, your support act's here. So we were all gig round. Can you give him 20 minutes just to do his thing? Yeah, okay. Who is he or whatever? I didn't know who it was. Oh, it's Paul Brady. He's going to be your support act.
You're joking.
Well, that's what we said. Yeah. What? Are you sure? The Paul Brady? Yeah, he's, yeah. Okay. So, yeah, we left the green room. And he was nice. He came in, said hello and stuff. But how our careers progressed after that. His was already on the way up. Well, he was already a star at that stage. And ours tanked.
Is that how
immediately after, just gone. We were after that. We came back to Belfast.
Well, you can tell that story forever.
Well, that's the story. I don't normally tell the tanked bit.
Okay.
Yeah, just, obviously, you've grilled me to death. But yeah, we came back to Belfast. We had two more gigs booked. One was in the Limelight in Belfast, which is a great gig, and the second one was in a tiny little village pub in Drumore in County Down, where the drums. We were sitting on the floor, and you know. People were watching horse racing. And I thought, we should be back in the Marquee. Like, what are we doing still here? And we had an opportunity to go back to England and live in London, but just life happened to some of the other guys in the band and we couldn't make it, so.
Is that how you ended up in Spain? On your next venture
well,
as a bar owner?
Well, yeah, it's sort of in the long and winding road, yeah. Spain was an adventure. I joined the general workforce and worked as a designer for years, but then I got an opportunity to go and open up a pub in Spain. So off we went to Spain and I would live there for...
Whereabouts in Spain, yeah?
Closest village, a place called Torrevieja.
Uh-huh.
And with 11 years there, the pub and with two pubs, the Lansdowne, which is our traditional pub. And then we opened up Leeson Street, which was a late night music venue. And Stillers, both there going strong. But I still played drums over there and the Dogs. And yeah, we played up and down the east coast of Spain, playing blues to anyone that would listen.
Wow.
Where did the painting come in and all this?
I have no idea. I always, as a designer, I always sketched, always drew, but I always did very small photorealistic stuff. And whenever we came back from Spain, life got in the way. My my then wife and I, we separated. We were still the best friends, but we just weren't good at being married together. So we separated, but the kids were going backwards and forwards between the two gaffs. And I wanted, of all my exes, I said, look, you look after the artwork because you'll be much more stable and I'm going to be, you know, with living accommodation, whatever. So she said, okay, cool. But we had a couple of pieces from a friend of mine, an artist called Terry Bradley, who's an incredible artist up in Belfast, very successful. So I decided I'm going to paint one of Terry's pieces, the biggest pieces, which is 6 feet by 3. So the kids have something that they recognize when they come and stay with me. So we did that, and I absolutely loved it. It was like just I had discovered a new way of passing time, of art, of expressing everything that I wanted to do. And I loved it. So I started, did something else, and I'd be painting 3, 4, 5 o'clock in the morning. And yeah, from there, things snowballed. People were noticing, friends were noticing the work and thinking, this is great. And I'm going, yeah, okay. And then one of the lads wanted a painting of Dave Grohl. So he said, well, how much would you charge me? And I don't know what, I don't know. So I got him to buy me a cajon. And we swapped the cajon for the painting of Dave Grohl. And then another friend said, look, would you paint the lads Led Zeppelin? Big Led Zeppelin fan. And his house is a bit of a man cave, so guitars everywhere. And I said, yeah, okay. So I did that. And we sort of swapped the guitar for that. He doesn't know it yet. Well, he does now. But he was supposed to give me some cash and never saw that. So I borrowed a guitar off him. So we've kind of swapped. And yeah, from there, things progressed. People started asking, you know, Facebook, Instagram. Mm-hmm. People started asking me to paint them things, which I find bizarre. But, it grew and grew.
And now you're based in Ardgillan Castle, like... How posh.
Yeah, I know.
Like you're painting there. You've become a man all of a sudden.
Would we say that? Probably not. But yeah, just things snowballed. And I've just ridden a wave of good luck and good fortune to this point. I did a painting of Steve Garrigan as a commission for a girl that I know lives in Swords. She moved out of the house and then couldn't afford to pay me for the painting. So I put it online, put it on Facebook, and got a friend request from Steve. And I thought, this is clearly a wind-up. But if it's a wind-up, it was fairly elaborate because he had 40,000 friends or whatever. So I thought, okay, yeah, hi, Steve. And I said, look, saw your painting. I'd love to buy it off you. And he bought it to give away to charity rather than another faceless guitar. He thought this would be a bit more personal. Then he gave me a commission. And from that, your credibility lifts within the art world. And then you saw on stage there the painting of Rory Gallagher. Mm-hmm. The family saw that online and got in touch, reached out. And then Donald, Rory's brother, bought that off me. So again, suddenly your credibility again lifts.
It just shows the paintings for people at home to see. That, you know?
Then after that, it was Daniel, his son, got in touch with me and said, look, we'd like to buy the rights to the image. And I thought maybe they're going to use it for T-shirts or whatever on there. So I said, look, you can have it. I'm not going to sell it to you. Please have it with joy. Please have it. But give me credit on your website if you can. If there's space anywhere at all, you know, this particular image is done by Glenn Matthews, which they did. But then I got a call to say that they were going to use it as an album cover.
Wow.
So, you know, you've got a Rory Gallagher album cover in your portfolio, your credibility and your just everything just lifts to a new level.
Did you notice a change after that?
Well, I became insufferable because Rory Gallagher album cover.
Hello.
Yeah, I'm an artist. just people took you seriously. And galleries then got in touch with me rather than me sending begging letters to galleries. Can you please consider my work? You know, galleries got in touch and said, look, will you come in and we'll have a chat? So, yeah.
Can you tell us about this one here beside us? Because I believe this is your favourite one right now, is what you said to me earlier.
Yeah, favourite one this week, probably. It changes. Like, a lot of artists say that the one that you've just finished, the last one you've done is your favourite. And it probably is because you've just finished it and then you can move on. But this one, I don't know. It's about a girl, I call it. And I don't know. I never paint people smiling. And... we talked about Marilyn Monroe earlier.
I'm a massive fan, by the way.
Yeah, the melancholy of people, I think, comes out well in in images like that. And I'll try and find photographs that aren't in the mainstream, that haven't been painted a lot, or, you know, everyone likes to have, see everybody, we're all happy and we're rock stars and Hollywood and stuff. But images like that, I just think capture someone's character and maybe the capture the moment a little bit better. So yeah, and from the day I finished it, I've enjoyed having it, if you know what I mean, in my collection, if that's the word.
Can I ask you, just because we're running on time, I'm getting a nod there, about one of your other paintings as well, Johnny Depp, because he's all over the news and everything.
Johnny is priceless to me right now. Yeah. That's WTF is what I call it, because that's what I do when I'm just looking at a painting and I've just made a complete rickets. And that was online. And there's a company now in Kinsale that are turning that into a huge metallic, big sheet of metal. And they're turning that into a piece of art, which I'm really looking forward to seeing. Wow. So, yeah, that's going to be online soon. Yeah.
How would you like to be remembered? You know, God, going forward 100 years from now. You think this is a funny question?
Wow. Thanks.
How
would you like to be remembered? Because if you're going to...
artists always...
I look a bit peaky here.
Artists always get more money.
Their kids get more money.
Get more money.
I don't know.
What's the story with
this
that?
And I thought,
why does that happen?
I would like to be remembered as... I like it whenever my work is recognised. If someone sees some of my pieces wherever, and I'll get a text message, have you got something in whatever pub, restaurant, whatever? I love that when people recognise it without seeing a signature. And I love that. And I'd love to be recognised as someone who stayed true to their style rather than... Because my stuff doesn't match curtains or rugs, or will you do something that'll match these cushions? Not going to happen. Mm-hmm. You know, I want someone, either they like it or hate it, I want a reaction. So if people recognize my work, whether they like it or not, I would just like to be remembered as someone who stayed true to the style that I like to paint, rather than chasing commercial success.
You weren't bought over.
Glenn, I think they're fantastic paintings.
Thank
and
you.
I wish
so
you all the success going
Thanks
forward as well. Like, you know, it's great to see, like, it's
after this, I'll probably tank,
like,
in another career. No,
definitely go for it. Just very quickly, just to tell the camera, I suppose, where you're on all the social medias. You were telling me you gave me a card earlier.
Instagram, LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, and anything else I can climb on board, any sort of, I jump on them all.
Well, definitely your Instagram is very interesting.
Instagram's good. I tell everybody, don't believe all the stories. I mean, you know, Brad Pitt's a big fan.
Oh, yeah, well.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. He's been in to see me several times. Keanu Reeves. They're all fans.
Yeah, that's cool. Like,
have you anyone that you'd like to paint now at the moment? That's in the pipeline?
No, I'm halfway through a painting of Hozier. And the photograph was taken by a friend of mine called Glenn in Dublin, and it's an absolutely amazing photograph. So hopefully if I can finish that. But after that, I don't know, I love obviously painting. Katie Taylor.
Going,
Now I have to do it.
Yeah.
I have to do it before she actually loses the fight, which hopefully she won't do. But like, she's on such a crest of a wave.
Sure is.
That's the one that I've sort of made a mental note. Next up, I'll start looking for images of Katie.
I think it should be me and Stephen, to be honest. Here we are.
Yeah.
Anytime.
I'm accepting deposits at any time.
Come here, Glenn. Thank you once again. Thank you very much for coming on the show. It's great to have
you
here.
Thanks,
we'll
really appreciate
the paintings
it.
More. Look out for Glenn's pictures. Folks, it's time for some more music. We're from Denise after, which should be joining us to tell us more about herself. For our last two numbers in this set, she'll be joined by the Wicklow Women in Harmony, a wonderful singing group under the musical direction of Denise in Spotlight Studios, which is down in Wicklow Town. And we'll have Jody Ullaman, Linda Webster, Julia Dobernig, Emma Clark, Elaine Quinn, Rebecca Carroll, Leah Cronin, Claire Watson, Shifra Pratt, Sarah Byrne, and Patrice Brady Carton. You're in for a real treat, folks. Here they are.
That Arizona sky burning in your eyes. You look at me and babe, I wanna catch on fire. It's buried in my soul, like California gold. You found the light in me that I couldn't find. So when I'm all choked up and I can't find the words, every time lovers in the night, oh, it's trying to run. We don't know how to rhyme, but damn, we try. No, all I really know is where I'm gonna go. You found the light in me that I couldn't find. So when I'm all choked, every time we say goodbye, baby, it hurts. When the sun goes down and the band won't play, I'll always remember us this way. Oh, yeah, I don't want to be just a memory, baby, yeah.
Doc O'Connor, absolutely incredible. It is my absolute pleasure to introduce, all the way from Spotlight Studios in Wicklow Town, Wicklow Women in Harmony, these incredible women who I have the absolute pleasure to work with. Together we will sing one of my favorite songs called Caledonia. Enjoy.
lost the friends that I needed losing, found others on the way. Well, I've kissed the families and left them crying. Stolen dreams, yes, there's no denying. I've traveled hard sometimes with conscience flying. Somewhere with the wind. Let me tell you that I love you, that I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you're calling me. Now I'm going home. But if I should become a stranger, know that it would make me more than sad. Caledonia's been everything I've ever had. Now I'm sitting here before the fire, the empty room, the forest choir. The flames have cooled, don't get any higher. They've withered now, they've gone. And I'm steady thinking my way is clear, and I know what I will do tomorrow. When hands have shaken, the kisses float, I will disappear. Let me tell you that I love you, that I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you're calling me. Now I'm going home. But if I should become a stranger, know that it would make me more than sad. Caledonia's been everything. Caledonia.
Pleasure to sing this song with you all. Thank you so much. I would like to take this opportunity to thank everyone involved in tonight's show. Angel Brennan, the most incredible, strong, empowering, supportive woman. Thank you for inviting me on the show here tonight. Thank you to Stephen Leeson. Thank you to all the crew here, to my fabulous choir, Wicklow Women in Harmony, all the way from Spotlight Studios. And to the incredible Doc O'Connor, what a pleasure it has been to work with you, Doc. Thank you so much. So for our final song, we will sing A Million Dreams from The Greatest Showman.
can build. Every room inside is filled with things from far away. Special things I compile, each one there to make you smile on a rainy day. They could say it all sounds crazy. They could say
a performance. Yes. Well, at the same time,
that Million Dreams, that song gets me all the time.
Brilliant.
Even on Instagram I use it all the time.
Put
I love
it,
it.
Great form.
Oh, super.
I'm looking forward now to get Denise yeah. over with us to yeah. Find out what's going on
to
in
grill her.
Of the world, which is my part of the world now. Wicklow and Blair.
Welcome to the show, Denise.
Hi,
you're
you
so blessed
having
to have
me.
You
come here. I'm at home on stage. I
fabulous.
Just come alive. I love it. And when I'm working with people that bring out the best in me, it's like
yeah.
It's a dream.
It's
the best.
It's a million dreams.
What more could I want? Yeah. It really, yeah.
Excuse the poem.
I know.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
How did it all start for you? Were you always a singer, you know, from the time you could talk? Because a lot of singers say that about, you know, singing.
I feel that was my language, actually.
Yeah.
Singing was my language. It was my way of communicating my feelings, mm-hmm. my thoughts, bringing myself into a new world even, you know, of dreaming, visualization. I mean, I'm all into manifesting
yeah,
and all
so
that.
Am I.
And I realized that I was actually manifesting from a very young age because I used to stand in my room, look out the skylight and sing my heart out.
The hairbrush.
I don't know.
I can't even remember. I think I was just there like this.
I did that.
And I used to visualize singing to crowds of people. You know, and I'd never experienced that. I didn't know what that was like, but yet I did. And I mean, I'm talking from being a very, very young girl. And that just, yeah, I loved it. So instead of watching TV, I was singing and I was songwriting. Writing lyrics, sure, I had nothing really to write about at that age. So I used to take inspiration from lots of different people and things. So I kind of, my mother got me singing lessons. Mm-hmm. And I trained with Sister Agnes Cecilia Nolan in St. Mary's College in Arklow. And then I went on to train with Veronica Dunn in Dublin. But before all of that, even though I wanted to sing, I wanted to perform, I knew what I wanted to do, I had actually very little confidence. So obviously my mum knew, okay, this girl has talent, she knows what she wants. Get her for singing lessons, go into the Arklay Music Festival. So I was 11 years of age and I was standing up in the Arklay Music Festival and I'd literally cry my eyes out, the lip trembling.
The stage fright, like,
for stage fright, yeah. Oh my God, fierce.
It's a real thing.
Yeah. Go back the next year, not because my mother told me to, because I wanted to. Like, I was fiercely determined to get over the nerves. And same thing happened. I went back the third year and I got through it and I didn't get placed anywhere, but I might as well have won because I was just happy that I went from start to finish without crying or without nerves getting to me, you know. And then a teacher in my secondary school in St. Mary's College gave me the part of Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz. And this was like amazing, you know, might as well have been like given a Tony Award or something. And that was really the transformation for me, that someone actually saw something in me and gave me that platform.
You're teaching as well, like you're a vocal coach as well. Yeah. Is that right? Like, I'm just wondering, how do you teach someone to get over the stage fright or to just keep fighting, keep doing it until you get over it? Or?
I think when you connect to something higher than you, when you connect to a love, to the music, to the lyrics, and you just, all of your feelings and your emotions are fully engaged and involved, you forget everything else and everyone else, you know? Mm-hmm. And even to this day, I still get nervous before I go on stage because I'm a human being, you know? You care, so therefore there's going to be a little bit of nerves. But I think once you know what it is you want, you know the outcome of what you want, everything will align for that to happen, you know. Adrenaline does it as well. But I think through practice, I think any opportunity to get out and sing, do it. Yeah, you know, just baby steps. And to have someone there encouraging you is so important.
I think nerves actually are really good in a performance because I think it means that you're never become complacent about your performance. 100%. That you're so in tune with it and you want it the best ever, that kind of... Yes. Butterflies and all that. That's just part of it,
yes.
Isn't it?
Yes, it is. But then you can be such a perfectionist that it's almost like, oh, can I do that again? But you know, that's live.
That's part of it, live theater.
Theater, and it's the moment, and the moment is what it is, and you just have to be okay with that too. But
tell us about your visualization and your meditation, because I'm really huge into that, and I think we're getting Stephen into it as well, aren't we, Stephen?
Yeah.
We're changing him slightly, slowly but surely.
Yeah,
it's really important.
I think once you align your thoughts with what you desire, and live from this space, from a heart-centered space. I think us human beings can achieve anything. I really do believe that. We are so more powerful than we realize. So I'm a qualified meditation teacher and I teach meditation classes and just to teach people to have awareness of their bodies, of themselves, you know, because rather than running the rat race and getting annoyed at themselves for getting upset or feeling nervous and crying, you know, that it's okay. And you have to acknowledge what is there in order for it to be released. You can't let go of something if you don't know if it's there or not, you know? So just to bring awareness to people that, you know, they actually can work with their bodies. They actually have more power over their body than they realize. And to, you know, sit into those emotions, to let them go, to listen to your body, listen to what it's telling you, you know? 'Cause we don't do that. We're always trying to achieve, and do what it is we think others want us to. And then we judge ourselves and we get annoyed with ourselves for different things. So it's just about getting in the flow.
I think our ancestors did. I think we lost it along the way when we became more technically inclined.
Yes.
That's where everything changed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I get my kids and I my 11-year-old now really isn't that into it. But, you know... they're having a moment. I kind of just get them to close their eyes, take a nice deep breath.
So they love you.
And they're like, is it over yet?
That's the benefit you though as well, to get a bit of silence.
Yeah, calm. Spend time.
Can you tell us about your traveling with Riverdance, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, how did that come about?
So, yeah, well, I used to babysit for a neighbour called Margaret Kinney, and she was an incredible woman because she was part of an agency in Dublin. And she rang me one day and she said, Denise, the agency, the Yvette Halley Synod Agency, are looking for people to audition for Riverdance. And she knew I was a singer, so she got me in contact with them. went up to meet them. They signed me, and then I went to audition for Riverdance. And I went for a lot of like, you know, trials and tryouts and interviews and auditions. And eventually, I got in. Someone had left. They were just waiting. They had me on standby. Yeah. Someone left, and they said, gave me a call. I was in DIT at the time, where I met my husband John, and off I went to travel for a year. By myself, didn't know anyone in the company, and it was the most amazing experience. I was still quite nervous, and I was the youngest of the choir, and in the choir would have been Darren Holden from the High Kings.
We've had him here, actually.
Yeah. Oh, amazing guy. He's and lovely, Myler, yeah. Lisa Kelly from Celtic Woman. So I really, like, they taught me a lot, and spent a year with them, and it was beautiful. Yeah, loved it.
And you were certainly got rid of your stage fright then in front of the audience.
Well, even the growth alone, traveling on your own or not knowing anybody, when you
that was a life
company.
Experience. Yeah. Imagine that. Like, yes, yeah. It was scary. Yeah, no, and you know, they were all in relationships and that kind of thing, being the youngest. Mm. But they were all so good to me, and I remember the American Tap Dancers, and they just took me on like family. They minded me, and yeah. They were great.
Tell me about the National Concert Hall at the Awaken Your Power event. Like that.
Well, it's amazing when things align, because, you know, I started teaching meditation in last September in Spotlight Studios. And I remember saying to my husband, John, I really want to have a studio to teach my singing, because I was teaching from home up until then in many theatre schools as well throughout the years, and Wexford School of Music. But up to that point, for a small period of time, I was teaching from home. So I was saying, I really want a studio to teach singing, to encourage people, to teach meditation. And I just kept talking about it. I kept visualizing it. And here I am teaching meditation in the most gorgeous studio, teaching singing to the most incredible human beings, the Wicklow Women in Harmony. And what an honor it is for me to have them here tonight. I feel like I did. You know, I feel like things do align. But you have to know what you want. Mm-hmm. And I feel like all the right people came to me, and I really believe that. I feel like everyone that's in my life is meant to be in it. You know, everyone's in my life for a reason. Yeah. They are women there who are just so strong, so supportive, so loving, so positive.
I can't believe it's the first time he's performed as well, yeah?
I know. Yeah, we've been together since last September.
Yeah.
And when this came about, Angel, when you phoned me and said, do you want to do the show? I was like, oh, girls, do you want to come on with me? Do you want to do... Yeah. So they're thrilled, and I'm thrilled. Yeah. It's great, you know? And it's just lovely camaraderie between us all, and... Yeah, it's fabulous. I mean, what a treat to sing with them on stage, you know, and they make such a beautiful sound. So, yeah.
I'm delighted for you.
Thank you all for coming along. I really,
so
really appreciate it. Fantastic performance.
Our pleasure.
And we'll have you back again for another one in a few months' time.
Thank
if you'd like, definitely come back again.
Oh, we'd love to. Yeah, and just a huge shout out to Kerry Smith from Spotlight Studios for supporting me and the choir and us here tonight as well. We love her. She's amazing. And her school, Spotlight Studios, is just flying the flag for theatre, musical theatre in County Wicklow.
Well, we won't forget you, that's for sure.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Thanks again, Denise.
Take care.
Thank you.
So much.
Folks, that's it from us. I hope you enjoyed that performance. Absolutely fantastic. And it was great that we had an artist flying in the show as well. Tune in again next week, same time, same place. See you then. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Good night.